So hello. On this series of Therapy Matters, I will be talking to Richard Geist, who is one of our most compelling thinkers and writers in the world of self-psychology. He's not only a compelling writer and thinker, but also clinician, and people are touched and fascinated, and sometimes there's a kind of raised eyebrow about some of his ways of wholeheartedly being with his patients. Richard is known as a radical cohortian, carrying Cohut's work from the 20th century to the 21st century. His ideas are summarized in his phrase, a connectedness sensibility, which for me really captures the essence of this current zeitgeist of emphasis on complex systems and relatedness rather than emphasis on entities. So we'll get started in our conversation that will first be about ideas, but I'd like to say that that theory, if it's going to be anything at all, if it's going to be helpful and not a burden, theory has to be in your bones, as Winnicott says. Theory has to be a lived presence in our lives and in the mind, not always explicitly, but implicitly in the therapist's heart and mind. And Dick gave a wonderful presentation yesterday at APSP, the Association of Psychoanalytic Self-Psychology, in which one of the audience members said, well, how is this theory in your bones? What does it mean to you? And I thought that would be a wonderful way to start. How is these ideas of Cohut's a living presence in your life? So welcome. Welcome.
Thank you. It's good to be here. Well, any theory that one uses, I think, has to fit with one's personality.
Mm-hmm.
And I discovered Cohut when I was being trained originally in ego psychology and was in a classical analysis, neither of which were going particularly well in the sense that neither fit with me.
Neither your own therapy nor your training.
Right. And I happened to come across Cohut's first book quite fortuitously, and it spoke to me, and I carried it around and for months.
Really?
Reading, rereading.
Wow.
And it I didn't understand the word self-object then, but it really became, the theory became a self-object for me.
And maybe you could say a couple of words about what self-object means for those people watching our video that might not know these terms.
People make it very complex, but to simplify it, it really means any person or non-human element that provides a function or many functions that help us to feel better about ourselves. In other words, that increases our self-esteem, that increases our affective coloring, that keeps us feeling whole and alive and invested in our activities.
Yes, yes. I think of self-object experience as a kind of emotional nourishment.
Right.
Emotional,
right.
And intellectual and whole being kind of nourishment. And you're carrying Cohut's book, and that being the nourishment for you, the inspiration for you, is very touching.
Right. Well, remember, Cohut was the one that said we need emotional oxygen in the same way that we need physical oxygen.
Yes, yes, yes.
Keep us surrounded by nurturing entities.
Yes. And that's such a profound statement that we need this self-object experience as much as we need oxygen.
And just like oxygen, which is both part of us and outside of us, self-objects are part of us and outside of us also, particularly in the therapeutic sense. When there are two people in a room, we would say the perception is that there are two people in the room, but the experience is that there's really one person in the room because of that deep connectedness between
Absolutely.
The two people. We experience each other as part of ourselves.
Yes, yes. The way Jenlyn puts that from a whole different arena there, from the philosophy of the implicit, is that there are two people, but there's one interaction, and that that we are interaction. That's what we're made of.
Yeah, and that's a sense, I guess we would say, of we-ness
in
the room.
Yes, yes, yes. So you had that with Kohut from the beginning, that sense of speaking to you.
Although I didn't know Kohut personally, but yes, it certainly spoke to me in a way that I could live with it as part of me.
Yes. Some of my most powerful self-object experiences are with people that I never met, that just feel part of me from the very beginning, and it sounds like. But what was it about Kohut that did that for you?
I think, I'm not sure I could have articulated it at the beginning, but now as I look back on it, I think what Kohut provided was a stark alternative to Freud's worldview. And by that I don't mean just the theory, I mean the whole philosophy that he provided of development and treatment was antithetical to Freud's. So, for example, instead of a frustration model of development and treatment, Kohut's really was, although he didn't articulate this at the beginning, it really was, I don't want to say gratifying, but it was, in, to use Bacall's words, an optimally responsive environment which promoted growth rather than frustration.
Absolutely.
Kohut was much more interested in building on people's individual parts and pieces, whereas Freud was interested in dissecting the whole into its parts and pieces. So it always felt like Kohut was putting things together and was emphasizing wholeness rather than parts.
Yes, yes.
And that appealed to me because I never understood the point of saying to patients, oh, you must feel angry, oh, you must feel sad, or emphasizing individual defenses. And Kohut provided me with a rationale for looking at the whole person and their sense of self at any given moment. So it was a much more complex understanding.
Kohut's emphasis on self-cohesion and the importance of the person experiencing themselves as a whole, experiencing themselves as human, as
and his emphasis, you know, the other sort of philosophical part of his worldview, he changed the whole notion that mental health, or Freud's notion that mental health meant becoming independent, to the idea that mental health really represented the capacity for seeking out meaningful relationships. He would say self-object relationships, but I think we can translate that into just what people think of as relationships.
Yes, well, speaking of translating, one of the things that I think is so powerful about your work is that you're helping us to get reconnected with the essence and relevance of Kohut's work by translating some of the terms into contemporary language and giving us new imagery and new models for how to be with patients in a way that's compatible with Kohut's ideas.
Right, right. And Kohut, again, was the first one to suggest that this is before, really, infant research took hold. He suggested that human beings weren't born with any kind of destructive aggression that had to be tamed or sublimated or educated out of people, but rather that kind of destructive aggression was always secondary to some kind of injury to one's sense of self.
Yes, yes,
and again,
yes.
Again, that's both a theoretical idea, but it's also a philosophical one. It's getting rid of the notion of original sin.
Yes.
So instead of the baby being born into an environment in which there was conflict, automatic conflict between the needs of an individual and society, a baby was born into an environment which, in which the baby could convey and seek out what he or she needed for development in a much more generative way.
Mm, yes, yes. And I can see how that model of what a person is fits so much more for you. Instead
right.
of seeing
right.
the patient as suppressing or repressing inherent aggression, seeing the aggression as a protection against danger, against injury,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and seeing yeah. the person as inherently connection seeking.
Right. What he did see as inborn was a sense of self-assertiveness, which Winnicott saw as mm-hmm. inborn also, but mm-hmm. Kohut, I think, embraced that, whether it be from Winnicott or on his own, we don't really know, but he did embrace that notion and
yes.
separated, so there was no longer this overarching aggression which could represent either self-esteem or destruction. But he divided the two. So I found all of that very compelling. And some of it resonated with, I had worked with Erickson for several years, mm-hmm. both as an undergraduate and a graduate student. And Erickson, despite the fact he was afraid to write about some of those things, talked about believing in a healthy, growth-promoting treatment, and talked a lot about his somewhat unsuccessful analysis with Anna Freud.
Oh, really? I
in
haven't
the context
read that.
Of, well, he never wrote about that,
oh.
but he did talk about
mm.
it. He was unhappy with that analysis, I think because it represented a worldview that he didn't buy into.
Mm. Yes, yes. I have given a lot of thought to how theory is always inherently telling us something to do and a way to be. And if the theory is somehow telling you to be a certain way or to do certain things that are against your basic way of looking at the world, there's this terrible sort of conflict. Like you feel like you should be being this way that this theory tells you to be, but it just doesn't fit. It's just not right. And people yeah. have to find theory that fits and that nurtures them and that holds them and inspires them. And you yeah. did.
Yeah,
and you did.
Definitely. It and otherwise one is kind of accommodating to a theory which doesn't fit with your personality. And then what you're saying to patients usually will feel false and superficial to the patient. And I think Kohut also humanized treatment. Not that he was the first one, but he certainly put a great deal of emphasis on the treatment being patient-centered rather than theory-centered. And, you know, we know some of the Ferenczi, for example, was along that line of the first person to wonder about patient-centered treatment rather than theory-centered treatment. But I think Kohut embraced it in a much more comprehensive way. And, you know, the classic example, I guess, is Kohut's reaction to talking about answering patients' questions, where he said to not answer a patient's question is rude and offensive.
Yes.
That does not fit with traditional psychoanalytic theory.
Yes. Yes. As I mentioned to you before, I sort of span these two worlds of self-psychology and Genlin's focusing. And many people in the focusing world think of psychoanalysis as offensive because it's a world in which patients are put into the boxes of theory.
Mm-hmm.
And Kohut didn't want that. And our contemporary theory is a theory of allowing our thinking and our ideas to deepen our way of feeling into the patient's experience, not sticking the patient into this idea or that idea.
Right, and that's where his notion of the patient knows far better than we do what he or she needs to heal.
Yes.
And he really embraced that.
Yes.
As opposed to being in a treatment where the authority figure was the analyst or the therapist who knew all, and the patient needed to come to see it the way the therapist sees.
Yes, that's right. That's right. And that so shows this change of zeitgeist also, rather than an authoritarian model,
right,
where the therapist knows and the patient is resisting if she doesn't agree. There's a model of more mutuality and finding together. And I love Kohut's quote about that he's found that mostly if there's a disagreement, his patients are right and he's wrong. But in the few instances where he's right and the patient is wrong, his rightness is superficial and the patient's rightness is profound.
Right,
I just love that.
I agree. I do too. And, you know, the classic example of how Kohut's atmosphere and emotional investment was different than many therapists, I think, is when Paul Ornstein was sitting in Kohut's office waiting for his supervisory hour, and a patient came out of Kohut's office, and then a few minutes later, Kohut came running out of the office as if he were chasing the patient. And when Kohut came back, Paul asked him, "What's going on? And what happened there?" And Kohut said, "Well, it's a long weekend and my patient was feeling very anxious. And after he left, I thought of something that might help him not be so anxious over the weekend.
Oh.
So I wanted to catch him before he went down in the elevator and tell him what I thought might be helpful." You know, that kind of thing was unheard of in those days.
Yes. A whole different atmosphere and a different set of attitudes was sort of embodied in Kohut. The atmosphere of caring and enjoyment and appreciation of the patient and togetherness that you describe as a connectedness sensibility.
No, definitely, he felt that. A lot of people thought Kohut was still emphasizing a one-person psychology back then, but he really wasn't, because his notion of empathy implied that the two people had to be interacting with each other in a meaningful way for the therapist to understand the patient. Mm. If the patient wasn't conveying things to the therapist, there could be no empathic immersion. It would be a guessing game.
Yes. So let's get into this issue of empathy. That's the sort of core, the heart of self-psychology, and it's such a misunderstood idea. And in the institute that's integrative institute, where I teach, many of the students will say, "Oh, you know, self-psychology and it's empathy. How long do you have to coddle the person and go along with them before you do the real work of confronting them?"
Right.
And the idea that that empathy is just being nice and sort of holding yourself back from the things that you really feel.
Right.
There's an assumption that the things that you really feel are your annoyance and your impatience and your boredom, that those are the authentic things, that the concern and caring, those aren't the real things that you feel. So empathy, yeah. One of the ways that I like to think of empathy is Kohut's talking about that what's curative is for the patient to feel deeply understood.
Well, certainly in the 3 days before he died, his last lecture, he had been struggling with that for a long time, but he did come down on the side of saying empathy in and of itself is therapeutic. He didn't particularly express how it was therapeutic, but he did embrace the notion that it was therapeutic.
Yeah.
And I think, well, to go back to your other point first, you know, empathy has nothing to do with kindness, sympathy, and caring. It really, for Kohut, was a way to imaginatively feel and think our way into another person's world and experience that world from the patient's subjective position. So
yes.
It was a way to gather information
yes.
about the patient. Very different, for example, than a traditional notion of placing yourself equidistant between id, ego, and superego, which was the ego psychological way of gathering information. Or even for those Kleinians, for example, that use their countertransference as telling them more information about the patient, it's a totally different methodology for collecting our data.
Yes, yes.
And you can see that, you know, if you've read Freud's case history of Dora, there's a chapter in there called The Incident of the Kiss, and Dora goes to the storefront of her parents' best friends to watch a parade, and when she arrives, only the male friend of her parents is there, and he pulled down the awnings of his store and pulled her, Dora, inside and kissed her on the lips. Oh. And when Freud asked Dora, and one has to remember Dora was Freud's first dropout from treatment, but when Freud asked Dora how she felt, she said, "I felt disgusted." And Freud's response to that was, any girl of 14 who feels disgusted on her first sexual encounter is surely hysterical.
Oh, no, really?
And in fact, when Dora came to Boston later on and was in analysis, was Felix Deutsch, he wrote an article about her too, referring to her as an hysteric.
Oh my God.
I think he used the term oral hysteric, which in those days meant borderline. But but if you look at that example, you know, if we did psychological testing of Dora, she may have looked very hysterical on a Rorschach, for example, but that's a different set of data than if we feel and think our way into Dora's world. I think most of us would say disgust is the appropriate reaction for the severe betrayal of trust in people she thought she could depend on.
That story so shows the difference of worlds, of Freud's world and our world now, and then Coad's world that's a little you know, sort of in between there.
Coad constantly emphasized in his supervision the impact of the analyst on the patient, even though he didn't quite bring himself to write about it in the way he acted in supervisory sessions. I think probably because he was already being read out of the congregation for his ideas, which many analysts saw as heretical.
Absolutely. He was under a lot of pressure.
Right.
Yeah. And his self-object ties were to those classical analyst community.
But to get back to your point, I think we have gone slightly beyond Kohut now and think of empathy not only as feeling and thinking our way into the patient's world and understanding it, but then we would include in that empathic process Anna and Paul Ornstein's notion of the therapeutic dialogue. In other words, we collect our information and then we feed it back to the patient in a way which invites the patient to correct us or tell us how we're missing something or to amend what we're saying. So we're basically saying, does this sound right, or tell me if I'm wrong, but this is what I hear you saying.
Absolutely.
Also in the context of our own subjectivity, meaning we're aware of the fact that we cannot separate ourselves from how the patient is experiencing us or the world.
Yes.
Our subjectivity is important to the patient as well as their own subjectivity.
Yeah, so there are a number of points in that. The one point of the feeling your way into the experience of the other, which I think is, for me, it isn't described by data gathering. That seems so sort of objective, and we've sort of given up on objectivity in these days. But that feeling your way into a level of experience where you're connected, that isn't only intellectual, but your whole body, your whole, what Jenlin calls the felt sense of how the other is living in you and you in them, and you're going to this level. Kohut described it as the level where right and wrong are irrelevant, you know, that level where the patient's reality is profound, and you're finding in that, on that level, your felt sense of the person, and then expressing that, and then the person takes that and does something with it. And I love how you brought that notion of empathic process into a more mutual realm, that it isn't just the therapist that's being empathic to the patient, but both people are sensing into each other's experience and carrying it forward together, right? In this process
definitely.
Of back and forthness.
Yeah, and I think, you know, Kohut, unfortunately, he died too early to carry these ideas further, which I think he would have. But
and you're doing it.
I'm trying.
Yes.
But yes, he did mention the importance of the two people opening up mutual pathways of what he called empathic resonance.
Mm-hmm.
Although, again, a little vague back then, but just as you described it, more specifically now.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, both patient and therapist do experience each other as part of their respective selves.
Mm-hmm.
And it is one of the critiques of self-psychology, I think, is that the therapist gives up his or her own sense of self to be in the patient's world. And it implies that it's kind of a masochistic position. But in fact, those of us who use that empathic immersion don't find it to be masochistic at all, because what happens is the patient feels more deeply understood, and therefore you get more material, conscious and unconscious, from the patient, and it feels exciting to us. So
yeah, absolutely.
We're willing to subordinate our sense of self at times to the patient's feelings, thoughts, and ideas. And in order to subordinate your sense of self to the patient's feelings, I think you do have to have a strong enough sense of self so that that doesn't bother you, that that feels healthy and appropriate. And if you don't have that strong enough sense of self, you feel like your authenticity is being usurped.
You're so fighting with it inside.
Yeah. So I think some of it is that that one sense of self in some therapists is not strong enough to do that.
Well, I think that the notion that we're giving ourselves up, when you think of it that way, subordinating
right.
yourself, that there's something that can feel threatening, especially if you were the kind of child that Bernie Brancheff talks about, of the child that has to give themselves up to the parent. Then as a therapist, you don't want to give yourself up again to your patients. But some people talk about the empathic straitjacket, like I can't say the things I really think because I'm in this empathic straitjacket, and I have to just be with what the patient feels and thinks, and that's such a wrong-headed way of going about it.
Right.
I think of it more as entering into a stream in which my subjectivity, my values, everything is in there. I may be not expressing the thoughts and feelings that are disjointive at the moment, so that I can see what the person is getting at, where the deeper level that Kohut talks about, where who's right and who's wrong is irrelevant. You know,
right.
Like what's really going on here? But it's going to this level where our subjectivities are distinct, but they're also there's an us. So I'm being in the us, and sometimes putting the separate I that might have some other agenda aside in order to see what this us needs, where this us is going.
Right. And, you know, another way people misconstrue self-psychology is that we don't express our authenticity. And in fact, we believe very strongly that the patient needs to know us implicitly or explicitly, because otherwise they don't know what affective states we can tolerate and not tolerate. and for them to feel free enough to express their affective states, they have to know that it's safe. So Kovac very much believed in the patient getting to know the therapist.
Yes, yes, yes.
The difference would be that we don't think authenticity in and of itself is always good and therapeutic. We think that if empathically one understands that the patient needs to know something authentic about us explicitly, then we should express it. But it's based on our empathic collection of data from the patient, really. And in most instances, it's helpful for the patient to know us.
Yes, and I love your emphasis on that big welcome to for the patient to ask, want to know you, mm-hmm. expect to know you. Mm-hmm. I think of therapy as creating a new culture, a new us, mm-hmm. a new way of being, and that you're creating that together. And the expectation that questions will be answered, that gifts will be received, that there'll be a give and take, that vulnerability is mutual, that caring is to be expected. That uh-huh. culture is uh-huh. the culture from which new life grows, and the culture of withholding or the culture of a sort of pinning something to a board and examining it objectively, that culture isn't often, you know, a culture from which new life
right.
grows.
Right.
And I love how you will show your patients that you're that not only are you willing, but you're welcoming and wanting them to know you too.
Yeah, I think that's in the service of this being an interactive two-person relationship.
Exactly.
In which there
yes.
is, as you sort of described before, an us or a we.
Yes, yes, yes.
And that's how people, in part, get better.
Yes. I've sort of extended this idea of empathy for the patient and empathy for oneself to empathy for the relationship, for the system, for the mm-hmm. dyad, and what the two people are struggling with, like in couples therapy, you know, like
right.
what's the edge that we're trying to get? What are we trying to do here? I actually have an example that I could give to
yeah.
to
Go
make
ahead.
This a little bit more experience near. A person that I'm working with who falls into terrible attacks of self-hatred and mm-hmm. and anxiety, really very, very severe. I've noticed that when she goes forward with her project, which has to do with finishing a website, there'll be these attacks. And I see a relationship between the moving forward in the way she wants to and this terrible backlash. And after an absence, we got together. We were sort of a little disconnected. And she said, you know, you're so understanding and nurturing, and I feel so safe here. And I really love you, but I'm not making progress. I've had these attacks when you were away, and I think I need a CBT therapist that will really keep me on track and challenge me to finish this damn website. And why don't you do that? You know, why don't you? And I thought about it for a minute. It reminded me of Daniel Stern's Now moments, where everything is sort of... And I wanted to meet her there. And I said to her, I don't want to. I'm not going to do that. I won't do that. And she was so surprised because I had changed so much.
Right.
And she said, well, why not? And I said, because a part of you doesn't want to do that, is objecting, is having a fit every time we go in that direction. And she calls that self-destructive part a he. That's he. I said, we don't have his permission yet, so I'm not going to do it. I'm his therapist, too. And she thought about it, and then she lit up in a smile, and she said, well, I guess I'm not going to get help from you in that. I better ask a friend to help me with the website. But there was a whole different feeling of our coming together.
Well, it's also a good example of how empathically you picked up clues so that that was a time to be authentic and express what you actually felt. And, you know, that feels very different than a confrontation.
Absolutely.
Because it was based on your empathic understanding of where she was at the moment.
Yes, yes, yes. And it actually wasn't more authentic than a more, a softer inquiry into it. But feeling into the us in this moment where she was needing something contactful, something to come up against, to make connection. I felt like I could be that self, but that didn't really feel like that self was really more authentic necessarily, but as authentic, and it was a way of being empathic to the whole of her, which was this conflict between a desire to move forward in certain ways and a protective not being ready and are not really understanding enough about what the resistance was to the moving forward.
I think what you're saying is also important, and that is whatever we're saying to the patient is authentic.
If it feels like it's coming from your gut, not just
right.
A performance.
Right. And but I think some people would feel that, you know, to say no, I won't, is being a bit more confrontational, which it isn't in this example that you
yes.
gave. You know, if Kohut was not in favor, as we know, of confrontations, in part, I think, because he realized that if we confront the patient, we're doing what people have done to the patient for the last 20 years.
Absolutely.
And it hasn't helped.
Yes.
So why repeat that?
Exactly.
It's when the patient is ready, he or she will move on.
Yes, 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 yes. And I think that empathy is only known in hindsight when you're really empathic. That if she had been hurt, that I said, no, I won't, then it wouldn't have been empathic. But my sense of it was that she was needing me to come forward in that way.
Right, right. And that that brings up the idea that I think Kohut felt, and that was there was only one reality in the room, and therefore empathic failures are always defined by the patient. You know, we say things often that we think are brilliant and the patient feels injured by it, and
yes.
we say things that we think, how did I ever manage to say that? It's ridiculous, and the patient feels that was a wonderful
yes, 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 that's right. That's right. How were you so brilliant to
right.
say this? And you don't even remember saying it.
Right. So, you know, I think it's important to remember that empathic failures are always defined by the patient, not therapist.
Yes. A metaphor that I use is that self-object experience, empathic attunement, is not food on the plate. It's food in the body. So we might be serving up something that we think is wonderful, uh-huh. you know, empathic responsiveness, and it might be indigestible to the person. It might be have horrible associations to them and be inedible, and then we can feel like, oh, what's wrong? I gave you this empathy.
Right.
But empathy isn't like that.
Right. I mean, we don't provide, people talk in terms of providing empathy. We don't provide empathy. Empathy is not a self-object function. Empathy informs our self-object functions, I think. In other words, empathy informs how we respond to the patient. But we don't give anyone empathy or provide anyone empathy.
It's true. We can't go up to the gas station and pump out.
Right.
Yeah. So maybe just a few words about what we actually do with our patients in this contemporary age. It's all so different than the doing of psychotherapy and psychoanalysis was years ago. In my reading group, we were reading some of Dick's work, and other contemporary theorists' work, and some of the people who are experienced therapists were saying, God, everything is turned on its head. Everything that I learned is now the opposite. I learned that everything had to be not acted out but put into words, and now Daniel Stern says sometimes you shouldn't analyze what's happening implicitly. I learned that you should have clear boundaries, and now Richard Geist is talking about permeable boundaries. I learned that I should know whether something is for me or for the patient, and I shouldn't receive gifts from the patient. I should know what's going on, that's my role is to know. Now everybody's talking about living with uncertainty. And nobody told us that the rules are all changed, and we're so confused here. So I thought maybe we could talk a little bit about that, about what we actually do that's different than even what Kohut would have done in his time.
Well, I think one of the things Kohut did was give us permission to act. In other words, he also felt that deep understanding also was something that could be used in place of limit setting, so that there didn't have to be boundaries that were imposed from above, from the psychoanalytic police.
Yes.
That in fact are the boundaries between each dyad are going to be different.
Yes.
And
good
they
point.
Emerge from this we-ness system, actually.
Yes, they're emergent rather than imposed.
Right.
Yeah.
I remember very early in my career, I was working at a mental health center and saw a 14-year-old boy who people saw as very borderline, whatever that means, but they saw him as close to psychotic, and he was trying to get into a residential treatment center, and the problem was none of them would accept him because he was a fire setter. And he had been working with someone for 4 years previously to my seeing them, and that person had left, and his fire setting had continued. And I naively asked my supervisor at the time, has anyone asked John what would help him stop his fire setting? And he looked at me somewhat quizzically and said, no, I don't think so. And I said, well, do you mind if I ask him? And he said, go ahead. And so I asked John one day, was there anything that would help him stop lighting fires? Because John wanted to go to this residential treatment center. Mm. And he said, yes, there is. And I said, what? And he said, lighting fires with you in the office might help.
Oh, wow!
And we had a big iron wastebasket, as it happens, in the office. So without telling anyone what I was doing, I said, okay. And we began lighting fires in this wastebasket. And no one knew about this, except one day there was a banging on my door. And I went, when John was in the room with me, and we had a fire in the wastebasket. And you know how when you're in a room sometimes, as it gets more smoky, you don't realize how smoky mm-hmm. it is. And so I opened the door, and there was the fire department from the city.
Oh,
and
no.
There was smoke throughout the mental health clinic. And people were not happy with me, but...
I suppose not.
John stopped lighting fires. When we lit these fires in the wastebasket, he was able to talk about all the feelings and the dynamics that were contributing to his fire setting. And it was only during this fire setting time that he was able to get in touch with those feelings.
Wow, that's amazing.
And he
amazing.
Stopped lighting fires and went to his residential treatment center. I don't know what happened after that, but you know, those are the kinds of things I think I felt Kohut was giving me permission to do.
Yes, 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 yes.
So.
Yes. Yes, it's empathy is not only a way of thinking and understanding, but it's also an attitude, and it's also something that you do, that you were, this
well,
was empathy in
us
action.
Of what we can do action-wise mm-hmm. that is okay.
Mm-hmm.
There are no prescribed notions about what will be helpful to a patient and what won't be helpful. It's really all based on our understanding of the patient's needs. So it frees one up as a therapist to
Absolutely.
Do many things.
Yes, yes.
Some of them active, and some of them using words. I mean, I can think of another example of a 7-year-old girl whose treatment I was supervising, who at some point in her second year of treatment refused to leave the office at the end of the hour. And she just sat there ripping up paper and throwing it up into the air, and it came down in these hundreds of tiny pieces of scraps of paper. And her therapist said things like, I know you're angry and sad at leaving, but I have a patient and you have to leave. Your mother's waiting for you. And there was this notion that if you set these bounded limits, the patient would identify with the therapist's ego and eventually internalize that capacity to leave the office. Well, it didn't work, and it was going on time after time. And the therapist would end up carrying the patient out of the office, screaming and kicking.
Oh, God.
And there were, this was a waiting room full of people, so it was a big deal. And I finally said to my supervisee, you know, we could think about this in a different way, that the patient is clearly forming what we would call an idealizing transference. She wants to know what clothes you like, where you buy them, what kind of car you drive, and she wanted to be just like her looked up to therapist.
Yeah.
And I said, what happens when the end of the hour comes is that she loses that self-object connection to you.
Mm.
You're no longer, she's not able to keep you as an idealized other. Mm. So I wonder what would happen if you said, I know how hard it is when you feel so good when you're with me and then have to leave. It must feel like you'd fall apart without the connection to me. And I can't remember the Carol said, My teacher told us that if you drop a ball of mercury, it falls into hundreds of pieces, and that's how I feel when I leave.
Wow.
And the therapist said something about, so it becomes understandable how hard it would be for you to leave the office when you're going to fall into so many pieces. To which Carol said, yep, that's right, and left without a fuss. And in fact, never put up a fuss again about leaving the office. So I think, you know, there can be that kind of also informing of how to respond based on the theory that's sort of in the background
for us.
Instead of having to limit set or provide these rigid boundaries.
Right, that the therapist was expressing the feelings that the child was
not able to explicitly express.
Yes. So the child felt, in Cohut's words, deeply understood.
Right.
She went to that level where the child was experiencing it.
Right, and once she felt deeply understood, she could take that understanding with her rather than leaving bereft without the idealized self-object connection with her therapist.
It's also interesting to me that that it was your idea, because it's interesting that it's not just the dyadic system, but there are larger and larger and larger systems that we're embedded in. And in this case, you were feeling into the child's experience, and then the therapist was getting permission from you to feel into it in that way, and guidance from you. You were holding the therapist, who was then able to hold the child and not feel that she had to stop the child, confront the child, and then the child could feel understood.
Right. Right.
And then there are the people in the waiting room that's part of the system, Yeah, so thank you for that example.
Sure.
So maybe we'll get together another time.
Yeah, we should continue this dialogue.
Yeah. So much more to say here.
Right.
So thank you so much, Dick. This was a lovely conversation, and I hope that we continue it. And thank you for watching. And if you'd like to continue the conversation, you can get in touch with me through Facebook or YouTube and subscribe to my YouTube channel. And if you'd like to get in touch directly with Dick, they can contact you by email.
They can contact me through email.
And so any comments, questions are really welcome by us. The welcome in the therapy session is also a welcome to you, and we would love your participation in continuing this dialogue.
And thanks for having me. This was a fun dialogue.
Yeah, it really was. We're just getting into it.
Yeah, right.